Fitness for Recreational Scuba Diving by Dr. Franz Cronier. This presentation is intended to provide scuba divers with an overview of how diving medical practitioners consider issues related to diving fitness. How do we determine the risks involved or related to an individual's health when they want to take up scuba diving, or if their health were to change during a period in which they are already certified divers? One of the greatest concerns we have in terms of diving is the condition called panic. Panic is where a diver essentially forgets everything that they've been trained in and resorts to instinctive behavior. To use an example of this, if a diver were to lose their air supply underwater, or to run out of air, or maybe have a dislodged mask, instead of stopping, thinking, breathing, and acting in a coordinated fashion, the diver would instinctively hold their breath and bolt for the surface. And as we know, this could very easily lead to a fatal lung overpressure injury. So avoiding panic is one of the primary outcomes of training, and with that, the skills that will not only promote survival in case of an emergency, but also allow a diver to assist their fellow diver or buddy, and in fact to enjoy their diving experience. So all of these factors need to be considered in the overall assessment of a diver's fitness to dive. There are various scuba diving training associations, and each of them follows a similar set of principles when it comes to determining whether or not a person is eligible to dive. The core issue is that for most sports, there is no screening process. People who want to climb mountains, people who want to participate in other forms of sport and adventure activities, very rarely are subjected to a fitness assessment. What makes it different for scuba diving is that training agencies wish to release themselves of the liability of engaging an individual with a definite risk factor into their diving program. In other words, the reason why there are diving fitness assessment forms, usually in combination with a waiver, is to protect the dive training organization, dive school, or operator. It is not primarily in the interest of the individual enrolling, although of course, making an individual aware of the risks and allowing them to complete this form serves as a way of achieving informed consent. The challenge is this. For diving schools and dive operations, they wish to enroll as many people as possible. For divers, those motivated to undertake diving, there is an incentive to participate, and therefore neither the dive school nor the individual would necessarily wish to subject themselves to additional medical scrutiny because of an underlying or some intercurrent medical problem. The dilemma, though, is if a diver were to be trained, then there is a risk in terms of liability and safety for the diving organization or operation or school, as well as, of course, for the diver themselves and their buddy. In other words, there's more at stake than simply checking the boxes and being able to undergo training. It's about whether this particular sport, under these particular circumstances, are appropriate for this particular diver. When we consider fitness to dive, we don't only look at a single dimension. In fact, it's important to realize that there are physical, mental, but also certain social issues that need to be considered. And we're going to discuss these in a little bit more detail. Mentally, a diver needs to be fully conscious and alert, intelligent enough to be trained and to apply what they've been trained in, and psychologically and emotionally stable enough to be able to deal with the rigors and the variability of the diving environment. Physically, a diver needs to be able to equalize their air spaces so that they don't run into problems with Boyle's law. They need to be free of incapacitating illnesses or injuries or running the risks thereof. They need to be appropriately fit, aerobically fit in other words, that would allow them to participate in the moderate stress and physical exertion that would be required for typical recreational diving. And they should also be able to wear and use diving equipment effectively. From the social arena, which is perhaps the least obvious when one considers fitness to dive, there is, as mentioned, the liability of the dive school operator or instructor, but, also importantly, there is the responsibility to be able to assist a dive buddy. There's a tacit rule of diving, and that is that divers look out for one another, and that one diver should be able to not only monitor and share the diving experience with another, but there's an assumed responsibility that if something were to go wrong, they would be the first responder to a diving emergency. Therefore, if a diver is unfit to dive or at an increased risk to become incapacitated underwater, not only would they subject their fellow dive buddy to an increased chance of having to respond to an emergency, but they themselves may be less than able to respond to the needs of their dive buddy if they were to get into trouble. So, this provides a broader framework in which to assess fitness to dive. Buddy diving is one of the assumptions related to typical recreational scuba diving. In recent years, and with increases in diving depth, there is a tendency towards solo diving. But the culture of diving and dive education is built around the buddy system. In other words, it is understood that divers look out for one another. And it's not only same ocean, same day, but in fact, in touching distance. The risk assessment is not always obvious. Just as this sign indicates, there may be some obvious things that everybody would pick up on, but sometimes it is the subtleties that impose the greatest risk. It may not be the medication a diver's on, but the reason why they're taking the medication. It may not be the fact that the person struggles to equalize, but the fact that they are very anxious about the sensation in the ears, and this makes them vulnerable to panic. So there are subtleties involved that need to be considered. So, to start the risk assessment, in basic terms, one needs to consider the chances of a diver becoming unconscious or suffering some intellectual or mental impairment. There's the concern about the potential training failure, in other words, that the individual is unable to assimilate and ultimately apply all those skills in which they've been trained, or ultimately have some sort of coordination or psychomotor problem that prevents them from implementing them effectively. There needs to be exercise tolerance and an ability to both wear and use equipment effectively. There's the consideration of barotrauma and the effects of Boyle's law. And finally, the concern surrounding the possibility of suddenly becoming physically, mentally, or otherwise incapacitated, either by being injured or suffering an illness. Now, when it comes to unconsciousness and cognitive impairment, the basic rule of thumb that is applied is that there should be less than a 1% lifetime risk of unconsciousness. In other words, if you were to take an average person, there is a 1% lifetime risk of becoming unconscious for a variety of reasons, low blood sugar, low blood pressure, or whatever. When one assesses a diver with perhaps a medical condition such as epilepsy, seizure disorders, low blood sugar, and so on, the equivalent that this person is held to is whether or not they are at a greater risk than the average population would be. If they are, then the next consideration is whether this chance of becoming unconscious is predictable or unpredictable. In other words, if a person were to be at a risk of developing low blood sugar and this could impair their consciousness, preventing falls in blood sugar would make the concern about unconsciousness a predictable risk. Whereas someone who has uncontrolled epilepsy and could have a seizure at any moment would constitute an unpredictable risk, and therefore this would weigh more heavily against them being fit to dive. There's always the possibility that medication associated with the underlying conditions that may predispose a person to loss of consciousness could in themselves present risk factors. By that we mean that someone who is on anti-epileptic medication, maybe anti-hypertensive medication, or anti-arrhythmia medication. In other words, being able to control the heartbeat and heart rate. These medications, because they control brain and heart function, may in themselves cause the potential for loss of consciousness or impairment of consciousness. We also, of course, need to assess an individual's ability to just think and apply common sense. And this is sometimes a subtle thing to do. It's difficult necessarily to determine this during a diving physical assessment, but instructors instinctively and intuitively do make these assessments. What is hard is ultimately to apply the impressions that they get during training on the actual decision to deny a person access to diving. And in this situation, it is often helpful to have a diving medical practitioner or an organization like Divers Alert Network who is able to partner with the instructor and assist them in conveying the safety considerations to the diver. Training failure or problems with psychomotor agility and skills application. There are many reasons why divers may struggle to be trained effectively or ultimately to undergo the so-called operant conditioning that will allow them to participate in the sport in an effective way. One example would be divers who are underage, and for that reason, an age restriction of 12 years is imposed on diving activities. Of course, this usually constitutes junior scuba diving, but nevertheless, from the age of 12, divers for the most part can participate in all the activities associated with diving, notwithstanding some depth restrictions or the need to be accompanied by a diving instructor. The assumption is therefore that by the age of 12, a diver is able to assume the risk of participating in diving and has the necessary skills to use the equipment effectively. Intellect, of course, is required in order to assimilate the training information, such as how to use dive tables, use equipment, and so on. There should be emotional stability. Again, these are difficult judgment calls. If a person has a psychiatric diagnosis or is under treatment by a psychiatrist or psychologist, there is a red flag. In other words, there's reason to think that there may be problems. However, these problems may occur in people who are not undergoing particular medical or psychological treatment by a psychiatrist or psychologist, and that leaves it often up to the instructor to make a sound judgment. Phobias, particularly such as claustrophobia, fear of enclosed spaces, agoraphobia, concern of open spaces, hydrophobia, fear of water, and in fact even acrophobia, fear of heights. When water is crystal clear and you can see the reef way down below, divers may actually suffer from a fear of heights. Clearly, if divers do have phobias that are incompatible with diving, these should be identified and they should be protected from undergoing dive training. Incoordination is self-evident, and of course a physique able to wear the equipment effectively and bear the burden of the weight of the equipment and of course making use of all its functions. These are basic considerations, and in lieu of these, they would constitute a failure of training or psychomotor failure. Exercise tolerance, and of course with that, the use of equipment. In the past, there has been an assumption that divers should be able to meet a so-called 13 METS exercise capability. In practical terms, this means that a diver should be able to increase their basal metabolic rate, in other words, their basic metabolic energy expenditure, 13 times above the baseline. In simple terms again, this would roughly constitute the ability to run on a treadmill at roughly 13 kilometers per hour for at least 5 minutes. Now, if we were to hold all divers to the standard, we would probably lose about 70% of divers. So the reality is that even divers that are not considered to be exercise intolerant probably don't meet this standard. Where it's sometimes necessary to impose a slightly higher standard is when there are concerns about a specific risk factor, such as perhaps a cardiac condition, muscular weakness, or some other medical condition or injury that would predispose this individual to be unable to exercise or be exercise tolerant. In reality, nowadays, approximately 7 to 9 METS would be considered adequate, which would roughly be the equivalent of shoveling snow or running at a moderate pace. The New York Heart Association has a grading related to cardiac failure in which stage A means no specific impairment, and this might be a medical categorization that could be applied to an individual who has an underlying heart condition. Physically, a person should obviously have the stature, size, strength, stability of their bones, and simple things such as teeth to be able to accommodate, wear, and use the diving equipment appropriately. They should also have a range of movement that would allow them to access the equipment, retrieve the equipment, don the equipment, doff the equipment, and interact with the diving environment, such as the swimming pool or the dive boat. There's also the inference that divers should have basic watermanship. In previous years, these standards were fairly highly maintained, and there was water treading, underwater swimming, and in fact long-distance swimming that was applied as part of the screening process and training. Nowadays, these standards aren't upheld very strictly, and in fact there are divers that are not actually able to swim very effectively. The problem is when they lose the equipment, the basic watermanship skills that would be required in order to get themselves to safety or be able to maintain their survival and prevent drowning may be absent. And therefore, this is cause for concern. Barotrauma. Boyle's law affects all potential air-filled spaces. And particularly, when it comes to the body, one is concerned about ears, particularly the ability to clear and an intact eardrum or tympanic membrane. Sinuses. During an acute sinus infection, it is definitely unwise to dive. With chronic sinus infections, it's less clear. Some divers with chronic sinus infections actually improve or benefit from diving, because each dive is essentially like a sinus rinse. But it is not necessarily the case on every dive, and therefore sinus sufferers should be assessed in order to prevent damage, injury, and in fact a debilitating fracture of the facial bones as a result of barotrauma, which we have seen in practice. The lungs should not be subject to pneumothoraces, in other words collapse. We would certainly not want to see any overt scarring on a chest x-ray, which means that it is possible for the lungs to tear under strain. And there should be normal lung function tests, which means that the individual doesn't have lungs that are reduced in their size because of so-called fibrosis or scarring, or the airways being narrowed, such as might be the case with asthma. The gastrointestinal tract is also potentially vulnerable. Hernias, in other words, bulges of the intestines through abdominal openings, may result in entrapment of the intestines, and this could cause so-called strangulation of the bowel and be life-threatening. People who have had treatment for reflux disorders, specifically so-called fundoplications, in which the stomach is folded around the esophagus in a surgical procedure to prevent the stomach contents from slushing back into the esophagus, these individuals may struggle to belch or burp, and if they were to swallow compressed gas, they may become very uncomfortable during scuba diving, particularly during ascent. Then there are the concerns about acute incapacitation, sudden injury or illness. And all systems of the body are potentially involved. The head, ears, eyes, nose and throat, neurological, cardiovascular, pulmonary, gastrointestinal, genitourinary, musculoskeletal and dermatolymphatic systems could all potentially result in some sort of lesion, injury or illness that would make a person vulnerable or unable to be fully competent in the diving environment. Mostly, the consideration is whether or not the condition would be predictable. In other words, is there a way to know in advance that a diver who can choose whether or not they should dive may have a sudden onset of a problem that would make it unsafe for them to continue diving? These assessments are usually made by a diving medical practitioner, and for that reason, on the diving medical form, whenever there's a checkbox indicating yes to an underlying medical condition, the requirement is for these to be assessed by a diving medical practitioner. It is not to say that a person who indicates yes on a diving medical history will be denied access to diving. It is merely an opportunity to discuss the ramifications of the underlying condition, and usually it constitutes managing the risk factor and ensuring that that particular condition will not pose an undue risk to this diver when they undertake their sport. So, in practice, what should divers do? It can seem very confusing. The basic motivation that we have in presenting this information is that divers should take the medical waivers seriously. In other words, consider this to be in your interest. Read it thoroughly, complete it honestly, and if you are already a certified diver, but you're enrolling in a future dive training program, advanced diver, or perhaps even a dive leadership program, realize that diving medical conditions are important considerations, not only for your safety, but also that of your dive buddies, or potentially your dive students or dive clients. Each of the items on a typical diving medical questionnaire is relevant to diving safety. Don't just blow it off, don't just check them as no, but make sure that a condition doesn't apply. If you're unsure, call Dan, even prior to completing the form. Dan's medical information line is there to assist divers and diving instructors to make intelligent decisions as to whether a particular risk factor is important, whether a diving medical is required, or whether one can assume in advance that it is either not a problem or a likely contraindication to diving. At the end of the form, there ultimately is a release or a final physician's impression in which the doctor examining the diver may have a judgment decision as to whether a diving medical condition is or is not a significant risk. This does not prevent a diver from going to another physician or maybe omitting the information on a subsequent form. That would be a sad abuse of the principles of diving safety. The continuum of diving safety that is maintained by ensuring that diving operations are sound, diving instructors are well trained, diving physicians are qualified to make these assessments, are all there to assist a diver in getting an appropriate decision. If the diver disagrees, again, it is possible to call Divers Alert Network and sometimes even to present a particular case to the diving medical panel. In other words, that a collection of diving medical specialists can assist in making a final decision. What are the diseases and conditions that may ultimately be considered bad? Well, obviously those that would affect alertness, consciousness, exercise ability, general performance underwater, including wearing gear and using it, and pressure equalization. So, clearly, psychiatric, neurological, cardiac, respiratory, ear, nose and throat, musculoskeletal, metabolic, such as diabetes, and other acute diseases would be considered bad. In other words, a risk for a diver participating in diving. There could also be bad dives, which a diver may choose to avoid. And these would be dives that involve excessive exercise or exertion, a lot of exposure in terms of either temperature or long durations, elaborate dives involving a lot of equipment, or extremes of depth, duration, decompression stops, or distance to and from the dive site. All of these might influence a diver's ability to dive safely with an underlying condition. In other words, if a diver were to decide to undertake decompression stop diving, cave or ice diving, trimix, deep air, strong current diving, or diving in high seas, shore entries, and tough boat launches, these are variables that a diver may choose to avoid if they have an underlying condition. And these are the areas where diving medical practitioners and Divers Alert Network may assist divers in making appropriate decisions. In recent years, there's been a lot of controversy about children and diving. There are age restrictions, of course, but the principles are that the diver should be able to assume the risk, and if they are unable to do so, that the risk should be minimized and controlled by the dive leader, instructor, or parent. Unfortunately, one cannot always assume that parents have their children's best interests in mind. They may be so enthused about the diving sport that they may overlook a child's inability to adapt to the diving environment. For the most part, children have not been harmed by diving. There have been episodes of unfortunate events and even fatalities, but these fortunately are relatively exceptional. The concerns about growing bones being affected by bubbles are exaggerated. On the other hand, there is the potential for an increased incidence of intracardiac shunting, in other words, short circuits within the heart that would allow decompression bubbles to move from the harmless right side of the heart to the left side of the heart, that may very well affect children more than they would adults. The most important consideration, though, falls back on the mental, physical, and social responsibilities. And here, diving instructors, diving physicians, with the assistance of Divers Alert Network, may play an important role and form a safety net that would assist in ensuring that children are protected and safe and are able to enjoy the sport just like adults do. Diving is a wonderful sport, and recreational scuba diving offers a wide variety of intensity or simplicity of diving. Most divers, even those with medical conditions, may be able to dive depending on the conditions that they elect to dive in. There are certain conditions, such as epilepsy, uncontrolled diabetes, uncontrolled asthma, or cardiac conditions that may predispose a person to heart attacks or serious dysrhythmias, that would be a contraindication to diving. However, for the most part, divers can be assisted and the risks identified, allowing a diver to select the type of diving that they wish to undertake in safety. We hope that this presentation has offered a bird's eye view on the complex, broad, and multifaceted aspects of recreational diving fitness. Thank you.